There's one group that talked about a syndemic framework. And in medication, we look at synergistic versus additive. An additive, kind of like if you took two of something, it's like four, right? I think you're good at that. Synergy suggests that when you put things together, they potentiate, they're greater than the simple additive effect. And that's the way I look at these issues we're dealing with tonight. That's the research. This was on impact of AIDS acquisition management in neighborhoods and what the environment said, but they take this global statement. Now, if you're in epidemiology, we talk about the web of causation. Other schools may talk about systems framework or ecologic models, and we could parse those into different things. But for our purposes tonight, the idea is things are interacting, right? I've already mentioned one. If I have a health issue, it impacts maybe my employment, which impacts poverty, right? And if I'm in poverty, we're going to look at things that can contribute to health and how that begins to cycle around. Those with pen and paper, you should try and create your own creative maps and we'll challenge you to. There's going to be a lot of ideas here. Kind of toss them out. Whatever you do with them, just write them. I'm so grateful. If I wrote health, you wouldn't be able to read it. And I put it in this belt. Shh. Okay. What do we know about education? Start with education because I think that's the most important thing. Somewhere education goes in. Education. Increases in education show health benefits. How? Education and increased health activities. So education and health activities. I don't know. Lower education is associated with smoking behaviors. We'll look at others. So education and health behavior. I don't know if that might be a whole different thing. If you need me to move the board so you don't fall off the stage, don't put me in trouble. Education, decreased health-seeking information. That's another one for education. Think about that one for a moment. In my field, we talk about health literacy. Health literacy is your ability to understand the healthcare system and manage your health. Literacy. Health literacy. Health education. Health education. Health education. You got it. And educational. Yes, thank you. But a PhD has trouble navigating the health system and what the doctor told them, right? Imagine with a lower education, that idea of health literacy. What it means to manage that information. It's bad enough when we start talking about morbidity and mortality instead of illness and death, right? And it just goes up from there. We've already talked about how increases in education, improved engagement in health behaviors, and improved health literacy I was talking about. This is so important. Health education, education itself, I mean, is anti-poverty policy and pro-health policy. Mental health, somewhere get mental health in there. Mental health relates to food insecurity mediated by employment. Those with mental health issues have trouble maintaining employment. So mental health, employment, food, squeeze all that in there. We know that a patient with mental health issues has trouble holding the job. The caregiver, so now it's not the patient, but it's the caregiver of the person with the mental health issue has trouble holding their job because of the demands that they take care of someone. Good luck. Children, if you have a child that has mental health issues, finding them daycare becomes a problem. Things like increased cost if you can find a provider to take the child. Child care goes on there somewhere. Good luck, it says mental health child care. And again, the care provider providing for that child is jeopardizing their employment. We don't have the time to talk about childcare, but childcare is expensive. If you don't know it, you will someday, maybe. We're talking about people in poverty. So not only is it difficult to obtain, I'm working extra jobs, I'm told to stay overtime, I don't stay over, I lose my job. What happens when the child is past the hours at the daycare center? I lose my ability to placement my child there. I get charged an overcharge for the staying late. It's a cycle, right? Dental health. Turns out, poverty is associated with high dental problems. Oh, and you know what? Arrows to connect everything to health. And they can be bi-directional if you think it goes both ways and if you don't. But I kind of think most of them go both ways. Huge problem with soft drinks, but dental health. Dental health, we hear health policy around all the time, right? This idea of cutting benefits, whether or not we provide dental care. It's been in the news around the Affordable Care Act also. Why is dental health, health care providers will know, why is dental health more important than just my teeth? What else is it linked to?
Because it can affect your heart, the heart disease.
Cardiac health. It's like when I talk to smokers about bladder cancer, they're like, they don't make the connection right away. Dental health is related to heart health. So it's not just teeth. Now we're going to start talking about environment. Okay? Environment. That's the next theme here. There's going to be a bunch of environments. Neighborhood poverty is a strong predictor of mortality rates. I mentioned that before. The wider the gap, the stronger the predictor. So give me environment and we'll work from there. As the value of my neighborhood housing increases, we even get a percentage here, the value of my health increases. Okay? So let's go with something around health. Allostatic load. Allostatic load is this idea around wear and tear. Barbara Israel is one of my heroes. She's part of the study. This is done in Detroit. Neighborhood poverty, environment, equal higher levels of overall wear and tear, poor health. And when they did the regression models, it wasn't individual behaviors, right? Because I'm going to beat up on smoking occasionally, but you already heard, that's not the primary driver. Not that I want anyone to continue smoking. So kind of at a loss. What goes with environment and, we'll keep going. Oh, this is a good one. Environment and access. So access to health services has shown that impoverished neighborhoods have less access to primary care, okay? We mentioned this before. Access to healthcare is also shown to relate to vaccination rates, which of course have an overall impact on health. Neighborhood culture, increased smoking. Or neighborhood culture, increased poor health behavior, something like that. Any way you annotate that is good for me. In qualitative studies, they've shown that smoking behavior in impoverished neighborhoods, there's this strong culture, right? Community norms. So something around environment and culture. And isolation from wider social norms. Housing insecurity. We know neighborhoods, some, not all, impoverished neighborhoods have high transient movement, people moving in and out, losing stability in the neighborhood. There's a linear relationship with poor diabetic care. So diabetes and environment. You may have heard a lot about this, and if you haven't seen the film Urban Roots, you should, about farming in Detroit, urban farming. But I believe this first study was actually from Los Angeles, I'm not positive. The idea of food deserts. We know environment, nutrition access, so not just healthcare access, so maybe access with an HC and then an environment access with nutrition or something. And impoverished neighborhoods, we tend to see more party stores that have less access to fresh fruits and vegetables and higher access to fast foods. Built environment significantly contributes to obesity and diabetes. This is really important. Again, talking about this in the jail today, I'm so lucky they let me out. Issue of access to quality foods. Now this bound study was in Montreal, and they said, you know, if you have a car, you have good access to food, but if you don't, if you have to walk in Montreal, it really changed the access issue. So transportation is part of the environment. We were talking about this in the jail today, and this idea of, if I'm in deep poverty, I probably am not have a reliable automobile. I'm using public transportation, unless I'm using that corner store. I know Health Foods, Whole Foods just went into Detroit. I'm not shopping there. Great market, but again, there's issues of access and cost. So, I get on the bus. I bus out to Myers, Walmart. I'm not trying to plug anyone for the video. When I buy things, and that's a hassle, what's going to last on my shelf longer, broccoli or macaroni and cheese box? I may be in a box many years before that macaroni box is bad, right? That broccoli is going to be bad soon. If I buy all fresh fruits and vegetables, what do I have to do more often? Shop more often. If I rode the bus, if you rode the bus, to buy groceries, what's it like carrying groceries? Think about how that's going on. I don't know how that looks. Very good looking. But something about transportation, you've got good. All right, pop quiz again. Access to quality supermarkets. White neighborhoods versus predominantly black or Latino neighborhoods. The number available. A, about the same, 1.5 times as many. B, C, 2 times as many. D, and E, 6 times as many. It's 4 times. So again, thinking about disparity in access. I've been talking about environment related to some of these other issues. We haven't talked about toxicity of the environment itself causing health issues. So environment and pollution or something like that. This is work I'm associated with. I did create a reference list for those that want it, of all the articles used tonight. Of course, I didn't put my own on it, but you can contact me for it. Recent publication, we did a study. This is an international collaboration, myself as a small guy in the group, University of Windsor, Wayne State University, Henry Ford, Health Canada, a number of players, and we looked at the spatial relationship of pollution. Now, for me, this work is largely inspired by the work of Juliana Manté. This is a map she did in the Bronx, New York. It's looking at asthma cases and rates of poverty and pollution, and mapping to GIS mapping, geographic information system, blah, 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 spatial mapping. And her work shows that increased rates of poverty are associated with increased rates of asthma. And we know there's a long history of work. One of our retired professors, Charles Simmons, has written eloquently on it. Robert Bullard, there's others, that we know that minority groups and low-income groups are inordinately exposed to pollution. But in addition to this inspiration, what's the real inspiration for this work? Our children. Anyone that's come in off of 75 or down Jefferson through Rouge Planetary can see what we're talking about. So this is one of the maps we've done. This is nitric dioxide and spatially mapping what it looks like in the city. And then we take that map and we overlay it with the Henry Ford database of cases of asthma. And, just so I look like a PhD, this is a regression model that tells me there is a significant relationship between the prevalence of asthma and the prevalence of pollution in the community. Now, unlike Mantea's work, we have not applied the economic layer to this, but that's coming. So, increased environmental toxin exposure. You got it. Good. How about lead? We can't go through all the factors associated with problems with lead, but think about this for a moment, how they interact, because we've been talking about that. Brain development in children. Behavioral issues, hyperactivity. How do I end up performing in school? It's not on my list, but Needleman has written about violence and exposure to lead in society. Hearing loss, vision issues. How does education relate to poverty? How does poverty relate to environmental exposures, all right? Map of Detroit. Okay, cases of lead poisoning. This is from Urban Studies Institute of Wayne, 2012. We have thousands and thousands of children exposed to lead. You can see how the distribution is concentrated in phase zone. Environmental instability, I'm not sure how to plug that one for luck again. But we know that, again, as the neighborhood changes, there's instability. We know that there's been a long increase in, if you can move out, originally referred to it as white flight, but economics persist today across all races, that there are neighborhoods I want to move out of. They may be highly transient or major problems with housing stock. When we see increased deteriorating social networks, we see increased violence. So environment and violence. I said I had to pull in Steinbeck here a little bit. How can you frighten a man whose hunger is not only in his own cramped stomach, but in the wretched bellies of his children? You can't scare him. He is known a fear beyond every other. I do not believe that poverty is an excuse for violence, but to fail to acknowledge what it's like to have to face these issues of feeding your children, and what desperate people do is to fail to think through the issue. So, poverty can affect anyone, but violence affects everyone, regardless of income levels. But we know that certain rates of violence are excess in, let's pick something, running out of, in low-income neighborhoods. We know that children are more likely to witness severe acts of violence. So maybe something around violence in children too, right? Because it's not just violence, and violence in women. We know that women who experience violence are more likely to have problems at work. We know that children in communities of high violence are likelier to do poorer in school. There must be a narrow at that point somewhere between Violence, education. I'm going with the green, that might be fun. It might not work though. Boarded up housing. Some of you may be familiar with broken window theory. The number of broken windows in an environment can predict certain things. And likewise, boarded up housing was shown to be a strong predictor of these in that neighborhood. Premature death, all cause, premature cancer death, homicide, suicide, and a number of other health issues. So, environment, what is it when things are boarded up? It's boarded up environment. Now how about just boarded up? I like this quote from Winston Churchill. He's always used it. I'm borrowing from them. We shape our buildings, and they in turn shape us. This bottom picture doesn't come out well. Apologies to my colleagues. We talk about issues of room porn. All the coffee table books that show all the beautiful old buildings destroyed in Detroit. This is different than that. I'm not showing those to you. I'm showing you neighborhood housing, the streets our children are walking in. This is from the Free Press a couple years ago, April 12th. I cut it just down and showed the whole city, but to the neighborhood of Denby High at the time. Each dot on that map is housing that either is ordered for demolition, the yellow or the red identified, but no funding available. Think about walking down that block, what that housing looks like, and what that means to the children. Talk about high crime rates and education. Graduation rate, 62%, but able to pass the Michigan Mirror Reading Exam. There's issues with standard tests, but 7%. What does it mean for the children in this neighborhood? And yeah, there's a lot of success stories, thankfully, due to many hard work. The numbers are against us. I'm going to skip this just because of issues we had with the sound. I should mention homelessness. In the 90s, the theme was deinstitutionalization. Homelessness. We said, let's get them out of institutions and get them in community settings, people with mental illness. So we closed them. Anyone that goes down 7 Mile North, they'll see the old North, they'll shut down. And there's many institutions like it in the city. Where did they end up? This choir speaker we heard. I mean, tonight, but on the list that Dr. Syke read to us. They're on the street or they're in prison. Amazing how well we're finding prisons. It isn't just the mental ill. I love this graphic. There hasn't been a new one, so I keep adding to it. I'm sorry. But homeless high school children. Dr. Saldana does work in this. He's here tonight. Thank you for coming. When we talk to people about this, he tells me, children in our school system, and when we start investigating with the children, we find out how high that rate is. I was at a social function recently with a Canton teacher, but staff member of the school system told me you wouldn't believe the numbers, and I'm sure I wouldn't. It's everywhere. I don't want to be bashing just Detroit here tonight. And a third of homeless families are working. We've already talked about all sorts of different illnesses and general mortality. But think about being homeless and trying to manage your insulin. Where do you store things? How about what certain drugs are worth? Theft is a huge issue. So clearly, being homeless takes it to the next level. Somewhere right on there, inequity. Well, then I move past some of these because of time and get to this idea. Increasing gross domestic product is a nice thing, but no matter how much it increases, when we see wealth disparities continue to increase and that actual rates of poverty do not increase with the GDP, it has no benefit on overall health. Okay? So this idea of globalization improving the world is not showing that. Wade wrote, as an economist, this idea of motivation that the CEO deserves more than the floor sweeper, that's fine, but the reasonable margin for employment has to be there in terms of wealth and equity, that it gets to a point where it's only discouraging and accelerates crime and violence because of these factors we talked about tonight. Again, I'm losing faith, and the video's been a little bit sketchy. We could play act this one out. That's such good. But instead of that, this segment comes back to these people that I talked about earlier. We meet the CEO, and he essentially says, the White Hall speaker, if you couldn't hear him, said, we originally were thinking that we'd see higher cardiac morbidity, heart disease, in the CEO because of that high-stress job. And then we meet these people again, and the high-stress CEO says, I get to share my stress. I give that stress. I get to make those decisions. I have that power. And we work our way to the floor sweeper, who, while he's trying to talk, gets pulled here, gets pulled there, doesn't get to make a decision. He can't win. It wraps up with him saying, oh, this vacation I went on was so great. You get that sense of, oh, so where is the stress? So let's think about that, vacation and stress in the workplace. Ireland, Sweden, France, Spain, Portugal, and other Western European nations where the manager causes have pay holidays. I suspect everybody will get this one right the first time. How many mandated by law in the U.S. paid holidays are mandated paid holidays? A? I guess we won't all get it right. Or you're just not participating. E? C? D? E? We have none, people. Not that we don't have national holidays. We have no laws that guarantee pay. Unlike those socialist others. Since 1965, think about the increase in wage rates, okay? A little disparity to the CEO that makes now over on average 354 times. So what are these things I've been talking about? Wealth, income, dollars. What are dollars? Why do we have dollars? Do you like dollars? Okay, well, let me answer for you. There was a time when if I had to carry my dollars, how about this, salt? Have you ever heard anyone salt or salary? Salary is derived from the word salt, they say. As a means of currency, what if we were bartering, right? Let's swap chickens. What if Bill Gates was paid in chickens? But really, and he's a good person, right? I mean, in terms of being very philanthropic. But think about what's happened with the wealth disparity. The dollar is, I'm sorry, camera's rolling, but it's a theoretical measure. It's what we say it's worth. And it works really well compared to carrying chickens. But when we start messing with economic systems that manage only wealth, we see strange things happen. that are hard to conceptualize. When we look at changes in income, and it's cut off, but it's really groups of defined middle class income, not the extreme highs. Only the very top quintile has really increased. And when we look at average taxes over a similar period of time, it's only decreased. And yet, remember going back, we keep hearing this idea of, you know, no taxes, big government's scary. Thank you very much. Now, I want you to share with these people this map. I don't know what your map looks like, and you've done a fantastic job. My writing is so bad. But we've talked about interacting individual factors, social factors, the fact that disease rates and death are higher, and how these things really create this idea of structure, of persistence in poverty, because again, when I'm not working, I'm sorry, when I'm sick, I can't work, I don't go to work very much, what happens? I might lose my job. Again, you can create scenarios, I hope, by this beautiful man. Gotta come back to the greatest wrath, this common reading. Living in poverty is contextualized against growing capitalist systems of wealth. Steinbeck talks about that. The quality of health, and more overtly, deaths, I'm assuming you all read, including the stillborn child of Rosa Shearer, all suggest significant impact of poverty on health. Steinbeck. Since this novel was written, we've seen a huge growth in wealth inequality. So, to get done toward change. I asked you these two questions earlier, or at least put them up there as statements. My measures were excellent, but how well does it serve the spectrum? There's a theory around things that say, hey, look over there. I think that's a hey, look over there issue. I think a better question is focusing on the healthcare system misdirecting our attention? How many times did the healthcare system itself appear in this? Maybe once or twice. Think about that. What's really driving this? There's high crime in the neighborhood. Politicians are running for election. What do they promise you? More police. Are police causing the problems in the neighborhood? For some people, yes, but that's not the point. By and large, I have many friends and family members involved in police work. My goal is not to bash the police. My goal is to say, when the politician starts saying, I will get you more law officers, that's good. When my house is on fire, give me a fireman. But the fireman didn't create the problem. To fail to look at where the problem's coming from is a failure to correct. Recent employment report said there are three people unemployed for every one job before controlling for things like, am I even fit for that job? Just gross data. So will screaming, go get a job, work? No. Two out of three people are still in trouble. Showed you data on intervention strategies. You need to quit smoking. You need to exercise more. We should have got that one. Inability to exercise in the neighborhood. That's okay. Environment and recreation. I didn't spend enough time with that. You know, just say no. For someone like me, just say no might apply. I have the resources to quit some bad behaviors, whether or not I knew it was a different issue. That's not what we've been talking about tonight. People don't have the resources. How does the U.S. rank compared to these other wealthy countries in smoking? Do we have A, the highest smoking rates, B, we're in the top 5, C, the top 10, D, kind of kind of the 11th, 20th, got a big gap there, that might be a safe one. Or really, the lowest rates of smoking, below the 25th. What do you think? A, high smoking? B, C, D, E. It's E. It's E. This is a wonderful fact here. And I know my time is up, just so we hear it. Japan has, at the time of this writing, I think it's 2008, Japan has the world's longest life expectancy and the highest rates of smoking in the industrialized countries. France also smokes more and lives longer than we do. Germans drink more and live longer than we do. It's not individual health behaviors. Are they important? Yes. If you're smoking, quit. Just say no. Individual interventions have shown low performance. We need to look at the built environment. The U.S. is spending, and I'm realizing it doesn't show up real well, but we're the top dark line here. Compared to these other industrialized nations, we're spending way more per capita and as part of GDP. It's not that we're not investing in health. I'm just not sure we're investing in the right place. Grace Lee Boggs, some of my colleagues here tonight encouraged me to read, brings our attention to this issue. Meet the new boss, same as the old boss. That's actually a Who song. The old people know that. But she talks about not disappointment, but thinking that seeing President Barack Obama take the role meant the world was going to change. And it's a great thing on many fronts. But the change has been truly minimal when you look at the system. She tells us we need to think differently, we need to act differently, we need to act locally. It's a wonderful series called The Hunger in the Valley of Plenty, and the epidemiologist comes out and says, we sit at this table every month and talk about the rates of this, the rates of that. Same. We didn't do anything. And then starts talking about, I got out of the office and went and acted locally. Attempts to reverse health inequities will be incomplete if the structural factors produce them are not taken into account. Distinguishing between ameliorative, calling the police, versus fundamental interventions, fixing the issues that require the police to work on job programs. Maybe we need to think about FDR's work programs. We certainly funded nation building elsewhere. It might be time to think about it here. Affordable quality housing, improved municipal services. Life is complex. When the media tells you, you're either with me or against me, that's baloney. Take the time, like my colleague here this tonight, thank you very much, and connect the dots. Think from the soil to the stars. It is not as simple as what they're feeding us. And you're here. You're thinking. Engage the world. Engage your community. Yipsy, and yes, the rest of the world. Care for yourself. It's like the airline thing. Put the oxygen on yourself. Take care of the kids next to you. If you don't take care of yourself, you can't take care of them. And keep working your way out, right? Some of us, everyone in this room, in my opinion, is blessed with a voice to be heard. Don't waste it. Not every one of us can serve on the street every day. I get that. If communities, leaders here like Mr. Anderson could work with Boys, volunteer his time, and encourage responsible children which grow to be responsible adults. That's a big investment. If it's only using your voice when you hear that distasteful racist joke to say, you know, that's not funny, do something. You You have that in your power. Thank you.